Ladies and gentlemen, the topic of this talk is on how to use neural techniques for vision-based semantic 3D world modeling. This means that we're going to do 3D scene geometry estimation using neural networks. We can do the same for getting semantic image segmentation, and then we're going to find ways to jointly estimate 3D scene geometry and semantics and map them in semantic 3D world maps. So as you know, it's very important for autonomous cars and autonomous drones to navigate on their own. This means that they need sensor data and AI algorithms for knowing the environment, and knowing the environment means that they should know 3D geometry and the semantics of the environment and the objects that are in this environment so that they can navigate safely. Traditionally, 3D geometry is obtained using sensors, for example, LiDAR, that are quite expensive at times. And regarding the scene semantics, typically we use handcrafted features. However, if we start employing deep neural networks, then we have a completely new way to estimate both 3D object geometry and semantics. For example, here you see a road scene, and then you can segment it using neural network techniques, and also you can estimate the 3D depth information. So I'm going to start first of all with 3D scene geometry estimation based on neural techniques. And as you all know, 3D geometry estimation is a traditional technique that stems from photogrammetry. And this photogrammetry relies heavily on image analysis and on multi-view geometry. However, nowadays we can use DNNs to calculate disparity or depth information. Typically, we have the following subtasks. First of all, we can estimate disparity and depth maps. Then we can create 3D point clouds, or we can represent the surfaces using 3D meshes, for example, triangular meshes, or we can even use volumetric models, for example, octomaps that are based on octrays. So originally, the DNN-based approaches, they extracted this disparity map from a stereo image pair, and they converted to an approximate depth map by using the camera parameters. And then disparity estimation can be based on DNN feature matching between the left and right image. And we can learn good image patch matches, and we can implicitly learn how to match image features. Recently, though, we went a step forward, and we can estimate both 3D geometry and also image segmentation using just monocular images. And in the initial attempts, ground truth depth maps have been used for supervised depth estimation from monocular images. However, this requires large databases that can be obtained using expensive sensors, for example, LiDARs. And recently, unsupervised depth and disparity estimation methods have emerged. For example, we can do unsupervised monocular depth estimation using stereo for training. And we can do it in the following way. Let's suppose that we have a left stereo image and the right stereo image. Then if we know the depth map Then we can go from pixel P of the left image to pixel P prime of the right image using this formula here, provided that we know certain intrinsic camera parameters, for example, the focal length and the stereo baseline, and provided also that we have an estimation of the depth map that can be provided by a DNN network with skip connections like UNET. To start with, we have such a DNN that is not really trained and we have to train it. To do this, first of all, we warp the left image so that it becomes similar to the right image. And then we define a photometric loss function. Essentially, we take the left image, the warped right image, and then this photometric loss function should be small. And we train DNNs using stereo image pairs so that this photometric loss function is minimized. And then during testing, things are much simpler. We just have a monocular image. We feed it to the DNN that has already been trained, and we produce this parity map. It's fairly simple. We can work in a similar way. We use a video stream rather than stereo images. For example, let's suppose that we have this video stream here, and let's suppose that we take two consecutive video frames and we try to find the relative camera pose between those two video frames. And this is done by the pose estimation network. At the same time, we use another DNN that does depth estimation. In this case, a video frame is used to estimate the depth map. We are supposed to know the intrinsic camera parameters, or that we can estimate them as well. And then initially, neither the pose estimation network nor the depth estimation network are trained. We have to train them. How this is done? Let's suppose that we are at point at pixel P sub T, and using camera information, intrinsic camera information, also using the camera pose information and the disparity map, we can map the same pixel in the second video frame. So this means that we can use the 2D point correspondences to warp the video frame at time T, so that it matches the warped image at time t plus one. And to do this, sometimes we may need to resort also into binary interpolation. Then, of course, we can define again the photometric loss between the video frame at time t and the warped video frame at time t plus one. And we train the two DNNs in such a way so that the photometric loss is minimized. Now, once these two DNNs have been trained, then we use just the depth estimation DNN only. We feed it with a monocular image, and then we produce the desired disparity map. And we get, of course, this way, 3D object information about 3D object geometry. So, for example, here you see that we have target video view, we have one DNN that estimates depth, another DNN that estimates pose, and when the system is trained, then we can essentially forget this part of the network, just feed the depth DNN with the target view, and we get an estimate of the depth map. If we use just the simple photometric loss, then we can have several problems. For example, we cannot handle occlusion properly. If we have complex illumination changes, we can have problems. We can also have problems if we have big homogeneous image regions. And if we have moving objects that do not conform to camera motion. So this means that we can include additional loss terms that we typically devise using computer vision techniques to handle all these problems. There is a problem on how far we can go, because if our test images are far away from the training image, then we don't really know how well we can generalize to solve these problems. There are ways to refine depth information, for example, by doing simultaneous depth estimation and optical flow estimation, or depth estimation and semantic image segmentation, as we are going to see later on. If we employ stereo video sequences instead of monocular video sequences, it's always better because they can offer richer information. We can generate 3D point clouds using the so-called units, for example, and in this case, we have an encoder-decoder system, and the encoder predicts the embeddings from the image and the random vector to perturb the prediction, and this is inspired by the generative adversarial networks. The predictor output in this case is a list of 3D points, for example, 1024 3D points. Instead of working with 3D point clouds, we can work, for example, with triangular meshes. And there are effective ways to do this. For example, we can start with an ellipsoid that models our 3D object, and then we progressively deform it using a graph CNN so that it matches our data. And as a result, we produce a 3D mesh that corresponds to the depicted 3D object. And there are other ways. For example, the 3D mesh can be formulated as a set of deformable 2D squares that cover a 3D point cloud. Another way to represent a 3D object is to use volumetric models. Volumetric models are based on voxels, and they can be generated either using depth maps or multi-view images, or sometimes even single images as an input. And there is a number of networks, 3D CNNs, for example, 3D recurrent neural networks that can be used to this end. This is an octree object representation here. You see we progressively go into more detail by using a deeper octree, and for higher resolution, without increasing the memory needs, octree is the way to go. There are some other issues that are related to 3D geometry. For example, let's suppose that we have partial 3D point clouds. Then how can we match them? We should match them, and there are various ways to do this. For example, we can use a 3D ICP algorithm to match two 3D point clouds. Or we can handle 3D point clouds using regular CNNs and smooth density value voxelization. Another issue is loop closure detection. You know that sometimes robots, for example, drones, they fly around and they come back to their original position. And once this is done, we can declare that we have loop closure. We can use loop closure to correct our 3D point clouds because the 3D point clouds we obtain when we are initially at a point and when we are finally at the same 3D point, when we return back to this, the two 3D point clouds should be consistent and we use it to correct errors. Then we go to the second problem in this presentation, which is semantic image segmentation. We use CNNs that typically have an encoding and decoding subnetwork to do 2D image segmentation. And we create a semantic image map that has exactly the same resolution with the input. And we have as many channels as the object class number. For example, let's suppose in this case, we have buildings here, and then we have fields, and then we have forests. So let's suppose that we have three classes. Then for each particular image pixel, we can assign, for example, value 1 for forest and value 0 for buildings and for fields. Essentially, we perform a per pixel image classification. There are various ways to employ CNNs to do this job. Typically, we use fully convolutional networks and dilated convolutions. And we try to grasp both the global image context while retaining the spatial image detail. This is important. And CNNs can do this thing for us. By using, for example, multi-scale methods or attention-based methods or network branching methods. PSPNet is a network that is of interest. It's a good balance between segmentation accuracy and speed. In many cases, various semantic image segmentation algorithms use it as a backbone. And each decoder is a pyramid pooling module or PPM that can enrich local image representation with more global image context at various scales. So here, for example, you see this pyramidal structure. Then we can have other methods, for example, that are similar to PSPNet. For example, we can use ATRU spatial pyramid pooling instead of the PPM decoder for segmentation. In this case, this ASPP module employs multiple dilated convolutions at different dilation factors. And this way, we can incorporate contextual information for image segmentation. And we retain fine spatial information in contrast to the global average pooling that is used in PSPNet. We can employ two separate network branches for accurate real-time semantic image segmentation. We have a spatial path. Here's the spatial path, which is rather shallow, and it preserves the spatial image details. And then we have a deeper network here, which is called contextual path. And it can extract high-level contextual information. And at the end, those two branches are concatenated and they are fed to a shallow CNN module for the final prediction for semantic image segmentation. OCR, which stands for object contextual representation, is another method for semantic image segmentation. We don't use dilated convolutions anymore. Instead, we try to find object region representations for this job, and the context of a pixel is the object where it belongs to. For example, here, if we use dilated convolutions, let's suppose that this is our target, then we can use ATRU's convolution, and then we can incorporate contextual information this way here you see that these regions are quite far apart from the original pixel position. On the other hand, if we use OCR techniques, then if we want to find context for this particular pixel location, then we use all this information that belongs to the same object, which is more accurate, of course. We can estimate both semantic image segmentation and edge detection in the following way. We can use two parallel network streams, one that deals with images, another one that deals with image edges. For example, the regular stream processes the image to produce dense pixel features. And on the other hand, the so-called shape stream processes both the regular stream features and image gradients. This means image edges. And this way we can produce semantic object boundaries. And these two predictions can later be fused together. We can also incorporate attention mechanisms for improving semantic image segmentation, because sometimes in semantic image segmentation, we may have spurious small regions or noise and we want to reduce it. And to this end, we can use learnable attention matrices. One way to somehow reduce complexity is, instead of using matrices that are full, we can just incorporate the attention mechanism only along horizontal and the vertical directions. And of course, as you understand, this is simpler. Now, we can either do separately 3D scene geometry estimation and semantic image segmentation, or we can do it jointly. Why should we do it jointly? First of all, we can create a semantic 3D map that contains both 3D geometry and semantic information. And we have significant gains. For example, we have better accuracy because one task can help the other one. And then we can also have faster computation because some parts can be calculated once. For example, there's no need to have image feature extraction twice. We can do it once for both tasks. In earlier approaches, essentially, if we had, for example, depth information, then we appended it to RGB images to create RGBD images, and then we use them for semantic image segmentation, because of course, depth information could really help into better image segmentation. We can use multitask networks for simultaneous estimation of depth and semantic segmentation maps. And they can share a common feature extractor, which is the encoder part. And then we have two different convolutional decoders, one per task. In the general case, if we have multitask networks, we have a common input image X. We feed it to the feature extraction operator, which is the decoding part. And then we have n different decoders, one per task. And at the end, we produce a number of different outputs. If we have multitask networks, for example, for depth and semantic map estimation, we can train them using just one loss function, which is a weighted average of the respective losses. We can take the variances of each network output into account for such a fusion in homoscedastic uncertainty manner, because this leads to better loss term weight coefficient learning during training. There are various other ways to do joint scene geometry and semantic image segmentation. For example, we have multitask network that is followed by CRF, or we have two separate encoder decoder networks that are followed by a fully connected CRF, or we can have a single decoder. So there are various approaches, and some of them are very new. And the two tasks can regularize each other using proper loss functions. And apart from the joint inference for both tasks, there is a research on executing either of them using the other one as a priori knowledge towards improving the accuracy. And 3D semantic image segmentation can be improved, for example, using a 3D point cloud that we have extracted from ground truth by employing a 3D graph neural network. In this case, we use graphs whose nodes are the 3D points. The node information is associated image feature vectors, and the edge information indicates the nearest 3D neighbors. So if we create such a graph and we feed it to 3D neural networks, we can improve semantic image segmentation using 3D depth information that is encoded in such a graph. Another way for fusing CNN predicted depth maps is to fuse them with depth informations that have been obtained from monocular SLAM. And then CNN predicted semantic segmentations are coherently fused with the global 3D scene model. And we can overcome several problems this way. For example, we can have a good estimation of scale. Typically, good scale estimation is an issue in 3D geometry estimation. And also, we can have better depth prediction in cases where we have areas that have no visual texture. Well, now we're done. We have estimated the 3D information, 3D geometry of our world. We have found the semantics. The question is how we can store them. And to do this, we need semantic 3D world maps. First of all, let's suppose that we know or we have estimated the intrinsic camera parameter matrices. Then we can use them to create 3D point coordinates from a depth map. For example, we can cast a ray passing from this image point towards the world. Then if we know the depth information, then we have a plane that is parallel to the image plane and it's a distance Zi from the camera center. At their intersection, we can find the 3D point coordinates. So we can transform a depth map to a 3D point cloud fairly easily. And then, of course, since the 2D image points have semantic information, then we can port this information to the respective 3D scene points because they're connected through projection. And if we want to store the information, if we have a 3D point cloud consisting of those triplets, then we can just augment it with label information as needed to store the semantic information as well. So this means that we can have a semantic 3D point cloud without really any major problem. However, if we use voxelized 3D scene representations, they can be more flexible and compact. If we work carefully, for example, we can employ octomaps, which is a 3D mapping method that is based on octrees. It can be easily employed for robot navigation, so we have good reasons to use octomaps to map our 3D information. And then 3D point clouds can be easily converted onto octomaps because we fill a voxel, which is an octomap leaf, if a 3D point lies in that voxel. It's as simple as that. Well, now the 3D point clouds have been mapped on the corresponding octree leaves. What can be done with their semantic information? We have semantic information in each 3D point cloud. And then if more than one 3D points are mapped on an octomap leaf, then we can do a max fusion. So we get the label that prevails among the 3D points that are mapped on this octomap leaf. Alternatively, we can use a Bayesian fusion approach where we can store multiple labels with different confidence values on each octomap leaf. And of course, in either case, semantic image information can be stored on octomap leaves using appropriate data structures. Here you see an example where we can have 3D information and at the same time, color displays semantic image information. There is a wealth of literature in this area, as you can see, and it's a very active research topic. If you want more information, then you contact me or you can get the lecture slides in this webpage. Overall, it's a very fascinating domain, and really, I encourage you to work in this area.